Pastor Bill Evans, Chetwynd, BC, Fellowship Baptist Church. Welcome you to our tuning into our service here at CHET TV. I'm really thankful to Marlon and company that put this together, and I think it's a good idea. We love Jesus. We love sharing the story of His great love and His care. So we invite you to pay attention for some thoughts we have. Just exciting days we live in right now that the pandemic has loosened up a whole bunch. And the things have been lifted, and at our church we've had some services. I had a really big funeral. The police said they noticed I had a bunch of cars there, and I said, well, why didn't you come and arrest me? They said, because the restrictions were lifted. So we're quite excited about that. But with the restrictions lifted, it's like the world was sitting fallow, and where we fallow ground, where, you know, the farmers don't put in a crop, and just weeds come up, whatever, they get turned back in, make some fertilizer for the whatever. Fallow ground, a sabbatical, somebody said. It's like the world needed a sabbatical, and God gave the world that. And now He's lifted that up, and we're gone back. And I want us to just consider today the idea, the highway to joyfulness. And there's a passage in Isaiah 35 I want us to just work through take a few minutes to work through a bunch of the verses if we can. So if you have your attention, Isaiah 35, you had a Bible, want to look in there? You may, and we'll read some words. And the first thing we want to see here is what would one expect to see? A highway to joyfulness, what would one expect to see? And the first thing we want to expect to see is the glory of God. The glory of God, somebody said, some theologians sat down, well, what is the chief end of man? And they come up with this conclusion. It was to glorify God and then enjoy Him forever. But the first part was to glorify God. And that is always to be our calling. If we have any interest in following God, it starts with us trying to glorify Him. We sing a song, in my life, Lord, be glorified today. And in my hands, in my work, all those things is that He be glorified. So we have here in Isaiah 35, verse 1, the wilderness and the desert will be glad, and the south will rejoice and blossom like the crocus. Blossoming. Spring has hit in my garden. The raspberries have been coming out and they blossom like crazy. And now I've got a bunch of raspberries in my freezer. He says, the wilderness and the desert will be glad. The desert is a parched piece of ground, and there's no life and nothing's happening. But God says, I'm going to change that. And He says, I'm going to cause everything to blossom. Well, He's going to send rain and whatever. But here, as we have gone through the desert parched situation, locked up at home, locked away from friends, unable to do anything but wear a mask and whatever, we have this new challenge that God says, the wilderness and the desert will be glad. And they're going to be glad that the gladness idea there is to brighten up. They will brighten up. It's been gloomy, dull, hard. They're going to glad. The gladness is going to come in time. The south will blossom and like the crocus. And then He says it'll blossom in verse 2 profusely. Profusely. And that's what I've got right now. I got just raspberries just blossoming and coming out, and they're ever bearing. So, and when you're picking through the patch, you think you got a bunch picked, and you walk by and more have turned while you're picking. And it just, this is what He says the blessing was going to be when He came to bless Israel after the struggles that they had been through. And so He said they'll blossom profusely, and then they'll rejoice with a shout of joy. This word rejoicing, one scholar said, it's got to spin in a gleeful situation. As a Baptist, Baptists long ago were frowned upon on dancing, and they didn't drink, dance, or chew, or go with girls who do. And so here, but this God says they're going to spin around with joy as they see what God is doing with the south blossoming and all these things coming to fruition there. This will cause rejoicing. And then He says, in the glory of Lebanon, it'll be given to them, and the majesty of Carmel and Sharon. Now, the people of the day understood what those things were, and it seems that they understood those are majestic things. Well, God throws them out there, and then He says this next thought. And the next thought says, but they will see the glory of the Lord and the majesty of our God. We see the greatness of the mountains. We see the beauty of the flowers. I'm working on my house doing soffit work, and I'm out there cutting on the soffit yesterday, and here's this little tiny spider. You know the song, the Itsy Bitsy Spider? Little tiny red spider. This is the glory of God who oversees the circle of the earth and makes little tiny creatures and knows them all. And here he says, the Carmel and all that glory is there, but they're going to see the glory of the Lord. The majesty of our God is going to be seen. And so when we think about a highway to joyfulness, it begins with us seeing and looking for the glory of God. The second thing we want to find is we should expect to work the work of God. Expect to work the work of God. A highway to joyfulness is yes. God wants it. Somebody asked Jesus, he says, what may I do that I could work the works of God? Well, they think, well, put money in the church or help Pastor Bill cut the grass or whatever. He says, doesn't do that. He says, the only work God wants you to do is that you believe. You believe on his son, Jesus. You believe on him. What you do after that doesn't save you. That saves you. What you do after that provides your rewards in heaven. But it doesn't say, he says, if you want to work the works of God, then believe. Believe on his son that he sent to the world. So what would I do that I might work the works of God? John 6:29 says, work, God gives you this job, believe. Another thing that he tells us after that, if you want to work as part of that work for God, with that belief situation, comes down to John 15 and verse 8. And he says, my Father is glorified in this, what? That you bear much fruit. Is he telling you about my raspberries? Yeah. You know, raspberries are a wonderful plant. They're very close to the Christian principle of life. What is it? Well, they're kind of Canadian too. They're red-faced and they hide behind out of sight. They're embarrassed. They're sorry that they're so nice and tasty and whatever. You ever notice that? And I tell people the way to pick raspberries is what? You got to get down low and look up. And you see they hide behind those leaves. The best ones, the tastiest ones, they get heavier and they get out of sight. And that's the way to pick raspberries. And here we find Jesus said, I want you to bear fruit. And so bear fruit, well, to do that, you want to be like his son. And that's what he wants you to have in your life. And so he says, and so prove to be my disciples. You prove that you're a follower of Jesus by the life that you live. And the life that you live shows whether or not you're following Jesus the way he wants. And so that's expect to do this work for God. Well, this work is believe and then follow and act like Jesus. And one other part there, he says, a new commandment I give you. So you got the Ten Commandments. This isn't there. This is written the same way. He said, a new one I give you. Love one another. Love one another. He says in the Bibles, love your neighbor as yourself. Love God with all your heart, soul, mind, your neighbor as yourself. He says, now, as individuals, love one another. And so you get a reciprocating love. And that's the great works that he gives. Now, back to Isaiah 35, he talks about people there. And he says, they're going to see the glory and the majesty of the Lord. Encourage the exhausted and strengthen the feeble knees. Encourage the exhausted. The Hebrew says there's something of the idea there, be alert. Feeble knees, as somebody's starting to totter, Pastor Bill's not there yet, but his knees are stiff. I'm going up and down my ladder. And starting to totter, we see seniors walking, and they walk with a cane, and they're three-legged people, someone refers them as. And because they're starting to totter, you want to watch for those people. And that's the idea what he says here. He says, encourage the exhausted and strengthen the feeble. So keep alert and watch for those because they might start to fall and you want to help them. And then say to those with anxious heart, be strengthened. And it's the same word encourage there and strength is tied into it. Take courage and do not fear. People live in fear. Fear of what? Fear and when they get older, fear they're going to have what their health is going to be. Fear of being lonely. And those are very real things where we want to work the work of God. Then we get involved to help and watch in those situations. Be alert and pray and ask God, is there somebody today that I might help by just going by or phoning and saying, how are you doing? Those are things he asks us to be careful of. He carries across the next part of my verse there. He says, behold, your God will come with vengeance and the recompense of God will come. And God will come and do his thing in his time. And one of the hardest things I find of the Christian life and dealing with Christians is that they want what they want right now. And the world is like that. It's a right now world in which we live. We got touched to everything in the immediate right now. And if you don't have it, then you can get it faster if you just pay more money and whatever. They want everything right now. And God says, I'll come and I'll do my stuff in my time. And give me time. Psalm 46, a great funeral hymn we often use. He says, he's a very present help And then just at the darkest hour, he's there to help. So he goes on from there to strengthen and physically help people and watch for them and emotionally encourage them and encourage them that God will be there. And then he has the last part we want to consider here in this Psalm, verse 8 and following. Who might you expect to see on a highway of joyfulness? A highway of joyfulness, the glory of God, and the those that will work the work of God and for His glory. Who might you expect to see on this road? Well, look at the statement. He says a highway will be there, a roadway, and it'll be called the highway of holiness. Holy people will be there on that road. The unclean will not travel on it, but it'll be for him who walks that way, and fools will not wander on it. Isn't it wonderful if you don't have fools walk on your road? The word there is that they won't meander out there. They won't meander, they won't wander out there. Why? Because Jesus made this statement, the road to life is narrow. The road to destruction is very broad. And one of the Old Testament said, there's a way that seems right to a man, but the end of it's death. And that's what people, let me give this big wide road, I can stagger and not fall off it, and then whatever. That road leads to destruction. They do fall off that big road, because if you're tipsy and you get close to the edge because you're nosy, you're over, you go. And so here he said, the expected ones on this road are the holy ones, the saints. And so the fools will not wander there. And those who are unholy, those who are defiled, they will not walk on this road. It'll be called the highway of holiness. The unclean will not travel on it. But it will be for him who walks that way. And fools will not, in holiness it seems, and fools will not wander out there. There'll be no lion. Well, we don't have a big problem with that. Lions, bears, getting to be some cougar in this country, lots of them. I've yet to see one in the wild. Whatever. We don't have to worry so much about lions, but physical things in life hinder us. And we've talked about that already some. There'll be no lion there, nor will there be any vicious beasts that will go on yet. These will not found there. But this is this final statement he makes as I wrap it up. He says, but the redeemed of the Lord will be there. The redeemed of the Lord. What does it mean to be redeemed? It means to be bought out from under some situation you're in. If you were a slave, you could have your freedom bought with somebody give you enough money. And if you came into it, you could have that bought. Somebody comes along and would buy and redeem somebody who was owed a whole bunch. And the book of Philemon in the Bible, Paul talks about that with a slave that had run away and had become a Christian, a follower of Jesus. He says, hey, you owe me, Philemon. So put what that Onesimus ran away, put it, whatever he owes you on my account. And so there. But to be redeemed is to be bought out from the situation you're under. God purchased his people out of the land of Egypt and brought them into the land, the promised land. And he offers us that same story, that we can be forgiven and have his help in our lives. So we have here the last thought I want to have. And the ransomed of the Lord will return and come with joyful singing. With everlasting joy in their heads, they will find gladness and joy. And sorrow and sorrowing will flee away. God calls us to a highway of joyfulness, to follow him, trust him, and to know his presence and his grace. Read your Bible. Ask God for help. He will meet you there, and he'll bring joy to your life. He wants to give you a joyful, abundant life. Amen. May God bless you. Thank you.